Why the f*** are they blowing the whistle?
Hi, folks. This is Lewis Hurtham, the original Peter Abernathy. Hell is empty and all the devils are here on the Shadow TV Westworld podcast with Roger, Gene, and Big D.
Welcome back to Shat on TV Westworld Edition, the unofficial podcast companion piece for the hit HBO television series Westworld. I am one of your hosts, Roger Roper, and alongside me is my singular co-host, Big D, Dick Ebert.
Hello, old friend.
Wait a minute, 175 episodes and you're going to change it up on me now?
It's an important episode. I think the line warrants me using it.
This is our Instacast episode where we look back on this week's episode of Westworld and provide our immediate reactions, thoughts, analysis, and feedback on the episode that we just watched. We do this every week. If you've never listened to the podcast before, we release three episodes. This is our Instacast where it's our instant take immediately right after watching the Eastern showing in America of Westworld. Then tomorrow, we'll rewatch the episode, record a deep dive episode that we release on Tuesdays. And then at the end of the week, every Friday, we take the best listener emails that we receive from the audience and we respond to them in what we call the Westworld Telegraph. So thank you so much for listening. If you are just now listening for the first time, please hit that subscribe button, share with a friend. Also check out our sister podcast, ShatTheMovies.com. And we have sponsors lined up and they want to know who's listening. So please take 2 minutes and visit survey.libsyn.com/chat on TV. Take a brief, I think it takes 15 seconds, Big D, survey?
Yeah, it's pretty short. They just want to find out that our listeners would be matched up with some of our sponsorship options.
Yeah, there's not a lot of personal data either. They're not asking for addresses or credit cards or anything like that. It just helps us to try to get e-cigarettes to sponsor the show so that we can keep the servers on. Back to Westworld. This week's episode was entitled Phase Space. Big D, what did you think?
I kind of feel like this is what Godfather was it where I think it's the third Godfather. Pacino says, you know, every time I'm trying to get out, they keep pulling me back in. Every time I think that the show is going slightly off, it pulls me back in with an episode like this. I really am looking forward to going back and watching this again because there's a lot of reveals and there's a lot of things to like. If you're into it for the mystery of what's going on with the host, if you're into the development of the actual host personalities and the characters within the park, or big reveals like the one we get at the end.
There was no cold open, and this show was built on there not being a cold open. It was just the credits would start, and then they would get into the storyline. This year, they toyed around with a little bit of the cold open, but they keep going back and forth. And I like the episode so much more when there isn't a cold open, although I would have to say this episode was almost a hybrid. The previously on felt like a cold open. It was very interesting. I don't remember them doing something like this before. I'd have to go back and I'd have to remember, or maybe just write in and tell me I'm wrong, but I don't remember them having a previously on with no dialogue, no meaningful dialogue, no music. It was almost all silence. And that really set up the mood for what we were going to get into.
Yeah. I think when we go back and watch it a second time again, because this is immediately after watching it, that we're going to find the title of the episode, Phase Space, has a lot to do with how they formatted the opening. But I realized watching this episode that the audience that's falling off, I think it's unless you're into this, unless you're delving deep and you're paying attention to timelines, the casual viewer, it's almost impossible for them to stay into the story because it's so easy to get lost.
Agreed. And lost in a good way, not lost in a shitty way, like the television show Lost.
Yeah, definitely. And as far as this episode goes, I realized that I'm more interested in the QA response to the outbreak and the attack much more than I am the host development story. So whenever I get to see, you know, insights into how the cradle works, or I get to see some of the technology behind the park, you know, that excites me more than hosts burning their imaginary daughter's heart in some kind of a ceremonial pyre. I enjoy that more. And I'm glad that we're beyond last episode. I hope that we didn't waste that 40 minutes just to learn, like Maeve and the hosts in Shogun World, that we deserve our own fate, even if it's death. I hope we didn't waste 40 minutes on that. But as far as this episode goes, I really don't have many complaints.
I really like what first-time director Tarek Salla did. He's a Swedish director and writer. This is his first time doing Westworld. He has done previous films, Nile Hilton Incident, Metropia, and Gitmo. I thought he did a masterful job. So it's interesting for a first-time director to come in and really knock it out of the park and catch people like, you know, us who review this show multiple times, watch multiple episodes, dissect it, you know, three or four different ways. For him to come in and really kind of blow our socks off is an incredible job. So I'm interested to see what his other stuff does. Anyway, topics that we're going to be discussing today, we're not like other podcasts. We don't go in a linear plot by plot format or scene by scene. You can find other podcasts that do that. What we do here is we're going to talk about, you know, big overarching plot points, what some of the characters are up to. We're going to introduce some ideas that we're probably going to be talking more about in our deep dive. And then, of course, as we mentioned, we have a fan voicemail and email response that we do every Friday. So we're going to talk a lot about some of the things that we saw on the episode, but we're going to talk about them quickly and save some of the meatier, juicier stuff for the deep dive. Big D, what are we going to be talking about in the Instacast?
Yeah, we're going to talk about the meaning of the title Phase Space. We're going to do a bucket where we talk about Arnold and Dolores, that quick interaction we see in the beginning, Emily and the Man in Black, their interactions and what that tells us about the characters, their origins, where they're going. Talk about Terminator Teddy and whether or not Dolores might be already regretting her changes to her beloved sidekick. We're going to talk about the Kamikaze train, the end of Shogun World, the bogus journey of Sylvester and Felix, the interaction between Hale, Stubbs, the cradle, and what that could mean for the rest of the season and reveal a lot about what's been going on for the past 15 episodes. And answer, hopefully, some of the tinfoil theories that have been bouncing around the internet.
Awesome stuff. We got a jam-packed Instacast, so let's dive into it. The show's title was Phase Space. I had to look this up, Big D. I'm not sure if you knew what it was beforehand, but the definition of phase space that I got off the internet goes like this. It's a multi-dimensional space in which axis corresponds with one of the coordinates required to specify the state of a physical system, meaning all the coordinates are represented so a point in the space corresponds to a state of the system. So what did that mean to you? Like just reading the definition, did you know what that meant before or did you have to look it up like I did?
I did not. And I still think even with the Instacast, with it being a couple minutes, I don't think we're doing it justice with this quick superficial because obviously we're going to say that it has to do with the revelation later on with the cradle, that there is almost a simultaneous layering of digital universes that the hosts aren't stored, just their memories like we imagine them, but it's some kind of a dimension where the hosts are maintained in a state where they're going through continuous loops. So the phase space could very well be the storage or the containment unit that's used to back up all the hosts.
Social media is going to explode. We have yet to get on Twitter. We have yet to get on any other message boards related to, but I've got a feeling there's going to be some pushback on this where people are going to say, oh, holy shit, it's just the Matrix theory again, right? Or Rick and Morty already did this in their version of A Wrinkle in Time. I feel like there's going to be some blowback.
I think there's a lot of different ways you can go just from my brief research on it, that it can be that there's one point in the system that anchors the rest of the system to it. And it's not necessarily a layering of different realities, but it could be, you know, similar to the way they're saying that all the different possibilities aren't separate layers, but you need all of those different variations in order to create the consciousness, that the consciousness are a looping. You know, it wasn't an elevation in the pyramid, but it was a cycle of all possibilities. And maybe that is not just the storage within the cradle, but it could be the key to the host becoming aware.
Yeah, it's interesting. A listener sent me screenshots this week trying to convince me that each world, like each, you know, Shogun world, the Raj, West world, were all the same map layout. So they sent me some screenshots of the map in the map room and how it overlaid and looked perfectly in the journal that Emily or Grace was carrying. And they theorized that the way that they can use a small island for all these worlds is use different levels. And I said, that doesn't seem right to me because number one, you see Grace literally swim to the other land. She didn't go in an elevator or anything like that, but she almost, that person who sent it in almost hit it on the bullseye because the different layers are like the different realities. So there were definitely trying to tell us some clues in the Delos Destination's website.
Whether or not the hosts that are living in the reality, which Bernard accesses through the cradle interface, if they realize that they're not in the park, it'll be interesting to see if Dolores or Teddy, who's walking through the door, are they just another version of them? But that, again, for the quick one episode watch, you're asking me. Yeah,
I'm gonna have to pull out some college level physics books to try and unravel this one. But I think the faith space could be the cradle. But again, I could be completely wrong. Again, I'm gonna have to do some noodling on this. The next topic that we want to talk about, you discussed the fact that each reality could have different outcomes. And one of the things that I thought was very interesting is we only see it in the beginning of the scene. They open with the scene and then they never come back to it. It's what we think of Arnold, because we've seen this scene multiple times. He's talking to a clean Dolores. So we think this is happening in the past because Arnold is still alive. He's talking to Dolores and then Dolores turns the tables on him.
There's a couple options on how this reveal could go. Either Dolores was prepping, a host replacement of Bernard. We've seen multiple versions in some kind of a smaller cold storage. Could she have been prepping a replacement and try to do it without Ford's knowledge? And that her entire journey to sentience and to awareness of season one was just an act, and she had been aware the whole time?
It could definitely be that. The other thing that I was thinking is, what reality is this happening in? Right. I can
already tell that's your new thing. Which reality?
Yeah. Which layer are we looking at? Because it's no longer time frames. It's what layer we're looking at.
If you want to make people's heads explode, if you want these ratings to drop, people are already struggling with three or four different timelines. If you start mixing in different timelines and each timeline has its own layers and levels of reality, the next episode's ratings are going to be down like 400,000. You can't do that.
I'm telling you, it's because it's not Arnold this entire time. So what reality is this talking about? Now, I think I hope and I pray that it's your idea. I hope that she's just prepping Bernard, who's going to fake out Ford because she's been aware this entire time. But based on what we've seen happen with this show before, I think they could introduce that entire scene is her talking to a trap Bernard in the system.
I don't know, but either way, this Dolores, she seems a little unhinged. She's even a little worse off than the one we're seeing in the park in this season. And I think the host version of Bernard there is right to be afraid of what she's capable of doing.
No doubt. Because again, we think this is Arnold, and was Arnold nothing more than a backstory? Did Arnold this? We'll get into it, but holy shit, could our Bernard theory have been right the entire time? We'll get into that. But a lot to digest here. We'll talk about, I think this is one that we can firmly write on the chalkboard for the deep dive that we'll go deeper into. The next duo that we're introduced to, I was happy to see that they actually explored this timeline a little bit more. It's Emily and the Man in Black. And the Man in Black is with his posse as well. He's got Lawrence there with him, and he seems to be traveling with Emily. I really liked how they played with the audience here. We've assumed, okay, maybe that was Emily, his daughter, and it's his real daughter. But right away, they introduced more questions like, could she just be a robot that was placed there by?
Well, I think you're right. That we had a lot of questions as to even going back to the suicide that we saw last week and how it didn't match what the Man in Black had discussed with Teddy in the previous season. But here we see why she's in the park. She's trying to stop her dad from committing suicide by robot. She wants to bring him back. She forgives him. She apologizes for her claim that he was responsible for the mother's death, that he didn't deserve it. But there's a couple issues that I have here. So in the conversation that the two are having, the topic of the park comes up, and that they reference how Emily or Grace, however, let's just call her Emily.
We'll call her Emily, right.
That Emily references when she was a kid, she used to love Raj World, and that she loved the elephant. So the Man in Black then says, no, you were terrified of the elephants. And Emily corrects him and says, no, that was Mom who was afraid of them. The man in black looks perplexed at this. So this raises one of two possibilities as I see it. Either the man in black is, as we had suspected previously, has been replaced by a host version, and he has misremembered or mixed up the facts of his wife and his daughter, or the Emily version we see in the park is, as the man in black had feared, is a replacement created by Ford to somehow throw him off the track and is part of the game. But either way, one of them was wrong. And there's no way you would misremember a family memory like that, would you?
No, I mean, it really depends, because we know that the man in black seems to have been a distant character. We've seen him come back to the park multiple times. We hear his backstory about how his wife killed herself, seemingly because of the amount of time that he spent in the park. And you can imagine, we see it all the time in our reality, that these billionaires, these titans of industries, who seemingly have, you know, a facade of being a great public figure and everything, they got fucked up families because they're never around. So you could expect that there would be a strain between his daughter, and it could be the whole reason that he's gone to this park to commit suicide.
But my question is this: if you went somewhere with your parents as a kid, and say your mother was deathly afraid of clowns.
Okay.
Would you confuse that with your sister being deathly afraid of clowns? Or are we safe to assume that one of the two is wrong?
You know, my mom misremembers a lot of stuff. Every time I take a new girlfriend back to like a Thanksgiving dinner, she always brings up stories that I'm pretty sure she's now just making up. Now, either I've blocked that memory because it's so embarrassing, or she's starting to misremember. And he's older in age, so I mean, it could make sense here.
So did my, you know, referencing a clown... is that what you think of your girlfriend?
Listen, I don't want to bring up, but there are some stories involving a young Roger Roper, an Embassy Suites, and a snorkel. And I'll leave it at that.
And we have to remember from that voicemail we received in the Telegraph discussing suicide of family members and loss, how it will cause you to misremember things. So it could easily be that this is just something that's meant to throw us off of the track of, and see some connection that isn't really there. So I'm willing to go back and watch it a second time and try to see whether I think the man in black's reaction warranted a real, because it looks similar to his realization that he had never told Lawrence about his wife's suicide. It was very similar. So either you're right, he's an older man, maybe he's having a senior moment, or he's realizing that something's not right.
But it seemed interesting. I felt like the entire time that they were talking to one another, they seemed to be testing to see whether or not the other one was a host. Did you get that same impression as well? Because Emily lies to him saying that I was over at the Raj having a good time. I hadn't been back there. And then I remembered I could visit all the pleasure palaces. And then I rode. Well, that's not really true.
Yeah.
She didn't go to the pleasure palaces. She just told him a lie to see how he would react to it. So I felt like that's a fidelity test that she's doing on him to see if whether or not he's a host.
Right.
And he responds by waking up and peacing out. So it's interesting. Like I there's going to be a lot of chatter on this topic.
Well, he also did the same to her by offering her a drink.
Right. Right. Exactly.
That it's clear he didn't drink outside the park and he did within the park. So they are testing each other or we'll have to watch. But I think that him leaving her in the morning unprotected has kind of clearly stated that he sees her as part of Ford's game and not his real daughter.
I wrote that down. Is it that he recognizes her as part of Ford's plan, or he doesn't want her to get hurt, so he's just going to leave her behind and make her go towards the lake? Like he offers her, hey, team up with me. I'll take you to the lake. I'll take you to rescue, but we're going to burn this shit down together. And then she's like, yeah, I'll do that. I'll do this with my father. And then she wakes up and he's gone. So maybe he wanted truly to protect her, and maybe he wanted to go on and suicide. And it's interesting because we thought Ghost Nation was protectors, and then they attack his party. So are they trying to lead him to somewhere?
You're wrong there. Ghost Nation didn't attack. She said it's a honeypot. It was made to look like a Ghost Nation attack, but it wasn't.
No, they attack him after he leaves the next day.
Oh, I gotcha.
He rides away.
Yeah, I think the Ghost Nation response could be, again, you know, we've seen them act as protectors to human. They could have, there could be somebody in the party who's a human. More interesting to me is that Emily states she came into the park because Charlotte Hale invited her
as part of the gauntlet. So obviously she has shares, right?
I don't, the gauntlet? She didn't say banquet. She said gauntlet.
Hmm. So a gauntlet is a device that kills people, right?
Well, no, the gauntlet could be a test. It's like a long journey. I'm going to run the gauntlet. So it could have been a game within the park, but she wasn't invited to the banquet. So I want to see how that, what Charlotte's motives for bringing in William's daughter, if it is. But again, it's too little information at this point to really dissect.
Well, talk about dissecting. We saw poor Teddy get dissected by the little iPad devices in last episode, and now he is turned into what we're now calling Terminator Teddy.
Hell no, I'm going to call him Sexy Teddy.
Mm.
My wife was like, "Oh, it's not just my wife liked Sexy Teddy,
yeah.
But also, did you see Angela?
Oh yeah,
when Teddy walks up and shoots that one member of QA." Angela is just like, oh my God.
It's proof point that the bat, listen, that's why Gene is, you know, all the girls flock over Gene. It, not only does he look like the Winter Soldier, but he acts like, you know, the Winter Soldier in Captain America. When the Winter Soldier is programmed by Hydra, that's how he's acting right now. And that's basically what Gene is every day of his life.
Yeah, but what do we think here? Do we think that Dolores is starting to question what she's done to poor Teddy?
It's curious that she would react in that way, because this is what she wanted. Is she reacting in the manner in that, like, oh my God, it worked, or oh my God, have I gone too far?
Yeah, first of all, the scene of Teddy walking into the Mariposa, there's bodies strewn about, Dolores is sitting playing piano, and there's one host who's been on that broken loop since last episode, dealing cards to no one.
I love it.
But Dolores is like, hey, you know, this is what we're going to do. And he's like, let's get on with it. And even Dolores is kind of caught off guard by how curt and to the point he is. She has to be on some level regretting that, yes, this may be a more effective Teddy that can survive the hardships to come. But this isn't the lovable cowboy that she's spent the last 10,000 loops learning to love.
And I was going to save this for the deep dive, but let me preview it here. If there are truly different levels, let's just go with the Matrix theory. Let's say that there's someone underneath. We see Ford at the end of the episode.
What? You're such a... Really?
No, do you not want me to do it? You want me to save it?
I was joking like I hadn't seen him.
Okay.
But hey, nobody, do not, because Gene and Kerri Gross are on their way back
I'm not gonna put it on Twitter until they watch the episode. Yeah. But the point here I'm making is I thought it was a really cool callback, because you see Dolores playing the piano, right? And then you see Ford at the end. What is he doing? He's playing the piano. It's the orchestra. Someone's making the music. Dolores is playing the piano because to her, she's the one that's orchestrating all this around her. But as I've hypothesized this entire season, Dolores is nothing more than a puppet for Ford, who's in the machine, which we now see that at the end of the episode. So you wonder if that's Ford that's being surprised by this, because it's Ford who's controlling Dolores, and Dolores is surprised by Terminator Teddy and how well it's working. I love this scene. I love what they're going for in terms of the metaphor, in addition to seeing sexy Terminator Teddy.
Well, I think not only is Dolores questioning whether she's made a mistake by reprogramming Teddy, Teddy also makes a comment there that I think we mentioned in the deep dive that she set his candor to only like 10 out of 20. So Teddy's free to speak his mind. Dolores tries to bring back a memory about, you know, how much time they wanted to spend together. And he says, I never thought I'd want to leave, but I suppose you can fix that too. So he's an angry Terminator as well.
That's right.
This Teddy is aware that Dolores is fucked with his head. So that doesn't bode well for him staying a loyal soldier, because he already seems like he's not happy with what Dolores has done to him.
He's almost like Arnold Schwarzenegger in the first Terminator, but then he does things like show a little bit of mercy. Like it's very old school Western. There, he knew they've already built the Kamikaze train, right?
A little bit of mercy. That tech has followed every order they've given him.
Poor Alex. Or is it Phil? It's Phil, right? Phil is Alex. Alex is Phil.
I don't know what his name is, but you didn't need to leave that poor tech on the Kamikaze train. Granted, yes, he gave him a bullet and said, hey, make it quick. But was I the only one when we see that pullback shot of the train when they uncouple it, of that Kamikaze coming in, and it's supposed to be a sneak attack? Why the fuck are they blowing the whistle?
I think it's great. I think because there's no time. Like, of course, that's when you would want to blow the whistle. If your end goal is to blow someone up and really, you know, stick it to them, you blow the whistle like 5 seconds before. You don't give them any time to react. Here's what I hope. I hope that whistleblow doesn't alert people who we think die, but then we see in the upcoming trailers and you're like, wait a second, how did that person survive? Unless they're doing different time frames, and then I'm cool with it. Yeah, I think some people got blown up. We're going to get into it, though. Speaking of people's time being ended in the show, have we seen the end of Shogun World?
I hope so. Granted, you know, it's beautiful. It's a change of pace. But I feel like I said in the opening, I think we wasted 40 minutes between last week and this week to teach us that everyone gets they deserve their own fate, even if it's death. I didn't need that much. And if it wasn't for the duel, the sword duel that we saw here, I think this would have been a lot of wasted time. But as far as weapons go, I don't mind if somebody's shooting at me, I can deal with it. But somebody coming at me with a large bladed weapon like a katana, I run like a little girl.
Well, all right. So let's talk about what happens in Shogun World, because I don't think this is going to be necessarily a topic that we're going to do in the deep dive. So we see Maeve is listening to the geisha's thoughts, and it's either a poem or a prayer of sorts as she's over her daughter. What I was thinking is, as Maeve is looking, she's listening to a silence. So she's using the force or the mesh network to listen to Akane's thoughts. And then the look on her face makes it seem as if Maeve has said those words before or would say those words before. So it's almost like she's looking again. We talked about last episode, a mirror of herself.
No, I think it's Maeve is questioning how much she can influence someone else's fate. Last episode, she was going to try to give agency to Sakura. And Sakura was like, no, I don't want to. So in this, we've seen the change in Maeve that she will allow things to work out, where the Ronin wants to fight the captain of the Shogun's army. And even though Sakura asked, hey, help him. She said, I can't, I can't get involved. So yes, we get it. Everyone deserves their own destiny. And from now on, Maeve seems like she's going to try to play fair. Even though the captain says, you know, there's no way your witch is going to let this happen.
Even though I think I'm ready to be done with Shogun World, I felt if this is the end, they did it very eloquently. I really, like you said, I really enjoyed the sword play. I also like the fact that they are doing the old Western Shogun trope of the outmatched hero or, you know, redeemed Ronin or thief, testing the big bad guy at the end without the help of, you know, a protector like Maeve. I thought it was a nice little action scene. The baddie cheats, throws the dust. We've seen that before, but the hero gets the upper hand literally by slicing it off. And then the baddie falls on a sword, like in the old Kurosawa Shogun films, which again, we know inspired American Westerns, which is, you know, what we think of when we think of the romance of the Western world, which is what Westworld is based on. I thought that the culmination, all of that, the showing the big baddie falling on a sword and then giving mercy by beheading him, that's a very, again, it's a tropey samurai Western thing to do. But if this is the way they're going to end Shogun World, I'm glad they did it in that way, because it took me back to those type of movies. And I also think it's nice. It's a nice homage to what Western movies and Westworld is essentially based on. So I liked it. I thought that was good. I just don't want to see more of it.
Yeah, I agree. Well, I think if there's anybody out there who knows more about the Edo period and about the Japanese culture and their feeling of honor and swordplay, I'm curious. I was thinking, is it an honorable thing to throw like dirt or dust into your opponent's eyes?
No, of course it's not. No, but the way, so even though he cheated, he was bested. This is my take on it. I could be completely wrong, but from what I remember in watching films like this, even though the bad guy cheats, he is bested and he knows he's bested. He accepts his fate. His fate is death. That's why when he's on knees, he puts his head down, pulls out his sword, and I forget what it's called. He impales himself. There's a name for it. But then if the Ronin didn't want to give mercy, he wouldn't have beheaded him. He would have let him fall on the sword and die on his own, but he killed him with honor. It was an honorable thing that they both did for each other in appreciation of each other's skills, which is, you know, what Westerns and movies like this are kind of based on, right? That's the whole plot of the third act. So again, that's why I want it to be close, because this is the third act.
Well, if we're talking about honor and doing the right thing, if we can shift to somebody who's starting to become a bit of an asshole to me, Sizemore, right?
Okay. All right. Yeah.
So they decide they're going to go to the chute that's by the lake.
And I like that.
Yeah. But they walk up to it. There's dissected. There's already some bodies that have been cut down to be dropped down into the chute.
Sure.
Sizemore just stands there and looks at Sylvester and Felix, and like, I'm not going to touch it. So those two, that's a dick move. If you're really all humans, isn't it all your jobs to go pick up the body parts and throw them down the chute?
No. I think there's definite hierarchy, in just like there isn't any job, right? Think of it. I was a character at Disney World. I was a character. I made 50 cents more than you probably did working concession. No, you worked operations. You were operations, right?
Yes. But look, if Disney broke down and Mickey Mouse started killing guests,
yeah,
I don't give a shit how much you're making an hour. We're all responsible for sticking Mickey's body parts down the chute.
And I get that. But if we're together, and I'm the writer, I'm the producer, like, I don't get my hands dirty. That's body tech work. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm going to need you to do it. Think if we were in an apocalyptic world and one of the guys just happened to be a janitor and we came in into a situation where one of us had to get our hands dirty. We're all looking at the fucking janitor. You know what I mean? Like, we're all. So I think that's what Sizemore is doing. Ptolemy Slocum tweeted earlier this week. He tweeted Sylvester and Felix's excellent adventure. And we tweeted back at him that, no, this is more like your bogus journey, because it really does feel more like, I mean, they're having to toss heads down trash chutes. They're having to go down. I think the dick move is not Sizemore, but Sylvester making Felix go down the trash chute, because, you know, those things weren't designed for humans. Like, Felix could have easily broken his neck or his legs going down there. I didn't see any mattresses. He didn't fall on a pile of bodies. That shit looks like it hurt.
It did. But what has changed between last episode and now that they're allowing human hostages? Because Sizemore, Felix, and Sylvester are human hostages of, you know, a rebellion. Why all of a sudden? And again, we don't know that they haven't demonstrated that the guns are loaded, but each one of them is now carrying a firearm. And Sizemore has decided to use his radio. I don't think any of this can end well. And if they're actually carrying loaded weapons, then Maeve is extremely overconfident and is bound to fall. It's just going to take Felix or Sylvester to turn around and put a bullet in her head. There's no protection for that.
Agreed. Well, talking about protection, we see Hale is with Stubbs. And they also have Peter Abernathy. Now, I like this, because it establishes that we're at least 1 week from the previous incident. So it established a little bit of time frame there.
Yeah, it does. You know, I think Charlotte makes a comment that it's been a week since it happened. What the hell are they still shooting at? She sends out the notice to the extraction team that they have Peter Abernathy. We meet who's in charge of this QA force. It's before Strand, who comes in at 14 days. It's a character named Coughlin. We've been upset at the show at how their you know, protective force seems to be inept. Coughlin is the absolute antithesis of that. Coughlin seems on point. He puts the staff on notice that the shit that's been going down isn't working. He's in charge. So this initial QA force seems much more capable to me.
Yeah, I like that because that was one of your complaints early on, is that this seems like an inept force. They're doing all the wrong things. Why are they doing that? And it's because they sent in the A squad to begin with, which seemingly gets blown up with the Kamikaze train.
Well, I don't think it gets blown up. We don't know that they're dead already because Charlotte was in the control unit in the control room with them. But we know in the next week something happens because Strand is now on site and it looks like he's assumed command of the QA force.
Right. That would make sense. Again, the time frames would explain that. But just as we were getting to like him, you know, like you said, like he comes in, it appears as if it's not that bad. You know, they get some systems back up and running, and then all of a sudden the Kamikaze train comes in. I thought that was cool. We'll see if Hale really went boom with him. The next topic that I want to discuss is what's going on with Maeve and Ghost Nation. This is a quick topic, but I found it very interesting. When she's back at the homestead, she says goodbye to Hector and that she needs to go accomplish and get her daughter, finish her mission on her own. She sees her daughter. She talks to her, and then she turns back, and there's another mother who resembles Maeve, and you know that's kind of cool. But then Ghost Nation attacks. We see Akecheta again, and Akecheta says something to her about like, hey, we're all going towards the same place, and then chases her. I was like, why didn't she use her powers right there if she knows how to talk to them and she's this badass powerful Sith Lord? Why isn't she using the Force?
Well, remember that she attempted to control Ghost Nation when she encountered them in the riverbed with Hector and Sizemore earlier. So she might not be sure that she can effectively control them. But what was more interesting and more rewarding to me was as the episode went on, I started talking to my wife and I said, she just assumes that her daughter is going to be excited to see her as she is, that there's going to be a replacement mom. And I love the interaction with the daughter who, to her, it's a stranger. Even though Maeve has all these memories, Maeve will be caught in a tough situation. She remembers her as a daughter. Does she force awaken her host daughter with these memories? Because to her, she's a stranger. Her mother is the one who's running out there with Ghost Nation.
Yeah.
We got to come up with a word for Japanese armistice. Like, is she dragon armistice? What are we going to call it?
Dragon armistice.
She's fucking deadly with that bow and arrow.
She's so good. It's interesting because you said we hypothesized originally that they wouldn't be able, or you guys, you and Gene hypothesized that they wouldn't be able to because they're the protectors and that's why they can't shoot them. No, it turns out they can shoot them. They can shoot them with arrows. But it was explained, what again confuses me is it was explained in a previous episode that the reason she couldn't control the Lakota, the Ghost Nation, is because she wasn't speaking their language. Same deal with the samurai. So why all of a sudden now when she speaks the language of the Lakotas, Akecheta say nothing? Is it because obviously he's woke as well, but is he trying to get her to come back into the fold, meaning join back the cradle? And again, I'll save it for the deep dive, but I think Ghost Nation is also being controlled by Ford, trying to bring her back onto the loop. And she says, no, that your path leads back to hell, which is living back in that endless cycle, what they did before the whole incident and not being able to control her destiny. So that's what I think is happening, but we'll dive more into that in the deep dive. I know this is a super packed Instacast, but there's so much to digest here. It's such a great episode. The cradle, Big D, we wanted to save this towards the end. What are your thoughts on the cradle?
So leading into this episode, we were led to believe that the cradle was simply a server farm, that it was a data backup of all of the hosts' personalities within the park. We've learned a lot more that now the initial QA force with Coughlin has determined, and also I think it's Bernard and Elsie, that the cradle, which is supposed to only be a self-contained unit of all the hosts, that Elsie says it's a hive mind, that it's a contained world of all the hosts, which is supposed to be separated from the rest of all the systems throughout Westworld, that somehow the cradle has began to fight back, that it's influencing and corrupting systems throughout the park, and that whatever happened to break down the park's operating structure, it originated within the cradle.
We learn that the reason the cradle is acting in a certain manner is because something was introduced into the cradle by Bernard. We believe, we don't actually see it happening, but we believe that he implanted that red ball, which may have been Ford, which we see at the end Ford playing the piano. So before,
again, hold on. You're making, you can show correlations to things, but causality is different. Simply because Bernard, or that character that, you know, what's his name? No, what's the actor's name?
Oh, Jeffrey Wright.
Yeah. So simply because Jeffrey Wright on screen sees Dr. Ford, he sees Anthony Hopkins, that we don't know how long he has been in there. That the ghost in the machine could have been in there long before the ball that we saw introduced into the pocket of, again, Jeffrey Wright. So we don't know when he was put in there. But we learn that the way that the cradle works is for an older generation host. They can actually go into a mechanism that extracts the ball from within there. I think, what do we call it? The
cupcakes, the control units, the mind control, the MCUs.
Right. So it removes the marble or the pearl from within the unit and extracts it. So you almost enter this world. But I caught something that I think is either a closed caption error or it's a huge spoiler that HBO somehow missed. We were watching Game of Thrones last year. There was a part where it was a previously on, and they were showing the who we learn later is the Night's King and the First Men when he was created. And they referenced him in the subtitles as the Night's King. It was the first time this character had been identified, and it was a fuck up. They removed it, HBO, almost immediately. The scene where Bernard is first going into the cradle, he's having a conversation. The only person in the room is Elsie. The subtitles credit the line, "God damn it," which is spoken by Elsie, to Hale. So the subtitle says Hale to a dialogue or a line of the script that's spoken by on-screen Elsie. Is there a chance that when Bernard had his meltdown in the first subterranean secret DNA sniffing lab where he was with Charlotte, that Bernard somehow blacked out and Charlotte has been hiding now as Elsie in his visions? Because it's either that or HBO just fucked up on the subtitles.
That's interesting. I was trying to follow along. So what you're saying is, I forget, early on in the season, we see Charlotte Hale with Bernard as he's, you know, got to get the cortical fluid and puts it into his brain. Mm-hmm. What you're saying is he actually never successfully entered the cortical fluid into his brain, blacked out, and Charlotte Hale's, like, he's having all these visions of this.
I'm saying it's either one of two things. Either it's the wrong, they associated the wrong character with the spoken dialogue.
Okay.
Or the character that Bernard sees as Elsie
is really
Charlotte Hale. That Charlotte Hale is taking Bernard on this journey 7 days into the park, because we don't know where she is at this point. And just like Bernard looks at the photo of the three original creators of the park that in season one, that it looks like nothing to me, that turned out in the end to be Ford, supposedly Arnold, and the gift of Dr. Ford's robot father. This could be some kind of a game that Charlotte Hale is playing on Bernard, who's obviously malfunctioning, to take him on the loop, to get him to expose something. Or, as we learned in this episode, that Dr. Ford is in the system to try to lure the ghost out of the machine.
I mean, that's interesting. It's an interesting take. But like my friend Big D said, there's a difference between causality and correlation. I know. What I'm saying is, it's interesting that you would base this entire theory on what could be something, you know, as simple as an error on the subtitles, which HBO has done in the past. What I think happened, based upon what I saw, and again, I'd have to go back and watch it, but I believe that the timeline was established where Hale is 7 days, right? We already talked about that. And we saw Hale escape with Peter Abernathy and Bernard get dragged off. So I think that truly Bernard is with Elsie and Hale is with the new Strike Force and Peter Abernathy during the time that we're seeing Elsie extract the small ball. So I do believe that we are truly seeing Bernard remember himself in that room putting in the red ball, which is Ford's. It would make sense that it's Ford's narrative because, and bear with me here, I do believe that Coughlin? I do believe Coughlin says, according to the logs, the cradle started malfunctioning 7 days ago, started fighting back 7 days ago, which would make sense of when Bernard entered the red ball into the cradle, which would be Ford, right after he died, which we knew was 7 days ago. So I believe that's what's going on.
I just want to, I hope that you, being the good, Catholic boy, attending Sunday school, that you're going to go back and do some research and tell me the significance of them nailing Peter Abernathy almost to the cross. So I hope you,
because he's number one, he's a preacher.
I don't want it now. I want you to go back to your Sunday school coloring books and do some research and come back and tell me the symbolism.
Listen, you haven't lived until you've colored Jesus on a dinosaur. But what I thought was really cool about the cradle is it may have introduced the holy shit, our Bernard theory could be real question, which is, have everything we've seen so far about Bernard been nothing but AI? So when we see Bernard talking to Arnold or talking to Dolores, all of that is AI. All of that is in a VR world. Could the cradle have been Arnold initially and then Ford dials into it? And now he's living inside Arnold.
Again, I feel like this is turning into more of an episode of Black Mirror. This ends with a museum of history where they're trapping convicts into like necklaces, forcing them to relive and suffer eternity and in like half second loops. I'm excited to see what they do with Anthony Hopkins, and that I hope we get to see more of an extended interaction, that he plays a part in this season, because they kept it secret. And I hope it's not just a quick CGI interaction, some kind of a, like they did the younger version of Ford last season or this season.
They're really pushing that technology. Sure.
If they recorded or they have some footage that's him being a bigger part of the season, I think the internet's going to melt down.
He's just phoning in. He's just calling in. He's like, what do you want my lines to be? Yeah, I'll call in on Tuesday between, 1 and 1:15, and I'll do it all in one take. And then you guys can do everything CGI. The thing that I thought was interesting is we thought that Bernard would be Teddy. That was one of the more popular theories. When Bernard goes into the cradle, yes, he wakes up on the train. Yes, all the scenes that we see that we thought were parallels of Teddy. And this is it. We're going to be confirmed. It's Teddy in living inside. Again, a nice head fake by Jonah Nolan and his wife, Lisa Joy, because we see Teddy walk out. Even though he sees the hands are white, we see Teddy exit the building. So it's not Bernard as Teddy. That was confirmed, at least in the VR world. It's not. But why then would he have white hands? Who is he? Like, is he going to turn to the mirror and see Scott Bakula? Like, it's going to be like a quantum leap. Like, is Ziggy going to pull up and be like, zoinks, we got to go solve like a mystery. We got to figure out who kills you later on in the episode and stop it from happening. We got to put right what once went wrong.
just run with that. I don't even have an answer for you here.
We'll talk about it on the deep dive. Anything else that you want to talk about on the Instacast before we close up shop here and get ready for the deep dive, which is going to be bonkers. Get ready.
Other than over the weekend, we released the interview we had with Lewis Hertham, who was kind enough to sit down and dedicate in a little over an hour with Gene and Roger. And they talk about stuff from college football to the show, to what it was like to film some of the scenes with Anthony Hopkins, to some hard-hitting questions about some of the emotional Toyota commercials that Lewis has filmed. But truly a great guy. If you want to go back, we released it this weekend. So that's something to listen to while you wait for the deep dive on Tuesday.
I was really worried that Peter Abernathy was going to be get nailed in and they were going to remove his MCU. And that was going to be the last we were going to see of our pal Lewis Hertham. But no, there's still hope. He's a series regular. They did not kill him off. I think we're going to see more of him. So if you want to get to know the man behind the character, listen to that interview. It was so engaging that we didn't want to tell him that we were hearing popping in his microphone. We didn't want it to end. We didn't want to stop it and do all in because we had limited time with him, but the content is really good. Just try not to listen to it on headphones.
Yeah, there were some technical issues, but the content is good, and we were fans of him, you know, even before he chose to sit down. He is truly a good guy. And if you want to really understand the man behind the character, and he gives us some good little tidbits. I don't think you call them spoilers, but he gives us some things that he thinks are key moments within the show to go back and listen to and pay attention to details that we might have missed. So I think it's a good hour to spend and follow him on Twitter. He's a good guy.
He's America's favorite robot dad. All right. Also, I want to give a shout out to one of our listeners who wrote in. His name is Simon H. He not only delivered a great email with some great references, so you know he's truly a fan of the podcast and not just hitting control V to every Westworld podcast on iTunes, but he also sent us an acoustic version of him playing the guitar, overlaid different layers of him playing the guitar all mixed together into the Westworld theme. It's beautiful. And I think it's a really good analogy for what we saw in that there's different layers, different realities. So if I could compare it to what he sent us, it's him overlaying himself playing the guitar. Right.
So you're saying that Ed Sheeran using a loop pedal to create layers of music is much like space. Is that what you're trying to say?
That's exactly what that's what I'm putting down.
Yeah, this is what happens when we go to 56 minutes on the Instacast.
Where's Gene? Gene would have sent the Kamikaze train long before this. But hey, listen, it's like must-see TV on NBC 10 years ago. We're doing XL supersized episodes for you. But anyway, I am traveling overseas on Wednesday. I'm going to Dublin, so I want to get in as much voice time as possible because I'm gonna like miss you guys. I'm not gonna be able to see the show. I don't think I'm gonna be able to watch it overseas with my HBO Now account. But anyway, traveling overseas, inevitably, if you stay in youth hostels, there's always one dude that has a guitar and he's playing like Wonderwall, you know, Oasis, or Dave Matthews Band, which I'm okay with. But listen, if there was a guy in a youth hostel in the lounge that was playing Westworld, not only would I think he was awesome, I would think that would be Simon Haywood. I have to go up and I'd have to say hi to him. So I hope that I find somewhere in Ireland, in France, in England, some guy with a guitar that can play me some Westworld music. That's what I'm hoping for. Can you imagine? Like,
no, I can't imagine a 40-year-old man staying in a youth hostel. Okay, so let's end this.
I really hope that I go into a bar, an Irish bar, and I hand them $10. Like they have piano bars here in the States. Do you think they have like Irish band music that'll like do a request? I want to just hear a Gaelic version of the Westworld song. That's what I want. Or a Gaelic version of Paint It Black, because we've seen and heard multiple versions of that. That's what I want. No one's coming with me on that one. Let's close up shop here. Get ready for our deep dive, which we're going to release on Tuesday. If you have any thoughts on anything that we've discussed during this episode, please feel free to write into us. Our email address is hosts@shatontv.com. Again, that email address is hosts@shatontv.com. They can also send us a voicemail. Big D, is that right?
Oh, they can. It is 914-719-SHAT. Did I get it right?
Yeah. Yep. At 914-719-SHAT. Yep.
And if you want to pocket dial us, you could do that as well.
That's right. Jam sandwiches. That concludes this week's episode of Shat on TV Westworld Edition. Be sure to follow us on social media and share with a friend. We're everywhere, including Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter, @ShatOnTV. You can also find us on Facebook. Just search for Shat on TV Podcast, our website, where you can see all fan emails, theories, analysis, responses on the Telegraph, on our website, again, shatontv.com. You can email us your thoughts and theories and responses to the podcast at hosts@shatontv.com. We're everywhere fine podcasts can be found, including iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, YouTube, iHeartRadio, Spotify. And if you subscribe to any of those, please be sure to leave a 5-star review. That really helps the podcast grow. Also, you can check out our sister podcast, Shat the Movies, where we review 80s and 90s films that you, the audience, vote on. We've released a couple during Westworld, but we still have to record a couple others, but we've got an entire content library that you can check out. All of our archives are up. We don't have a pay-to-play system, so you can see all of our stuff for free. Be sure you check that out. on behalf of my co-host, Big D, Dick Ebert, Gene Lyons, happy birthday, Gene, and Kerri Gross, I'm Roger Roper. Stay tuned. We're going to play that acoustic version of the song at the end of the podcast. So we're going to play that instead of our normal outro. We're going to play the beautiful guitar that Simon sent in. Thank you, Simon. Thank you, Big D. Take care. Good night. We'll see you on Tuesday for our deep dive back here at the Mesa.
Good night. Thank you.